In the last video, we explored when you pay a certain amount of money on a per gallon basis at the pump, how does that break down in terms of who gets what? How much of that goes to the gas station versus the transportation network versus the refineries versus the actual oil producers? The one thing I do want to emphasize is I just use that as kind of indicative numbers. They could change wildly based on what's going on in the market and where we are in the world, but they are fairly indicative. And the other thing I want you to realize is that they aren't always proportional. It's not like that if oil prices were to double, that this 15 cents that the retailer got would turn into 30 cents. In general, regardless of the price of oil, at least in the United States, the retailer tends to get between 5 cents per gallon and 20 cents per gallon. And it's normally in that 10 to 15 cent range. And some of that has to be netted against the 5 cents or so that goes to for credit card processing. Taxes can be relatively fixed. It's often on a per gallon basis. And the spread that the refineries get, it's also not necessarily proportional to the price of oil. There are times where the oil price is very high, but because there might be a lot of excess capacity at the refineries, they're not able to charge a huge premium. Or maybe they're not able to get a lot of the other stuff. So the refineries might not be able to make much, if anything, on each barrel of oil that they actually refine. Sometimes it goes the other way around. A low price of oil, if the refining capacity is really tight, the refineries can raise the price of the actual refined oil products, and then they can make more and more money. The players in this whole supply chain that do, whose profits are a function of the price of oil, are the oil producers. And just to be clear, sometimes all of these are owned by the same company. That's what they call these kind of vertically integrated oil producers. But if we just focus, but sometimes they are different players. And when they are different players, the ones that make the most when oil prices are high are the producers, because these producers, they invest huge amounts of money in research, in exploration, and then in drilling. And they make some assumptions. They say, hey, this oil rig that I'm going to spend $100 or $200 million on, this is going to be break even if oil prices are, say, at $30 a barrel. So obviously, if oil prices end up being at $100 a barrel, they're going to make a killing. They're going to make $70 per barrel of profit. And this thing's going to produce millions and millions of barrels. On the other hand, if oil prices go down to $15 per barrel, they're going to be killed. They're going to take a huge loss on this huge investment that they made. But the one question I want to at least attempt to address, and it's not a simple question, many people devote their careers to this, is what is actually dictating the price of oil? And we see it can't be just the traditional supply and demand, or at least in the short term it can't. Even if we look here at 2008, in mid-2008, oil prices were pushing $150, and then only a few months later, they had collapsed to $32 a barrel. They had gone down by a factor. They had gone down by a factor of five. And there is something that happened here. You had the financial crisis hit. Obviously, people's expectations of global growth would have been gone down. The economy wouldn't grow. People might use a little less energy, a little less fossil fuels, whatever. But that wouldn't be enough to justify a five-fold decrease in the price of oil. So something else is at play. And as you can imagine, a lot of it is just going to be the psychology of the crowd right over here, or the psychology of markets. People were driving up the price of oil. And over here, people freaked out and they started driving down the price of oil. And to think about that in a little bit more concrete terms, I'm going to think about oil markets in particular in the long term and the short term, or the long run and the short run. So in the long run, I'll draw the long run right over here. So in the long run, we can think of oil markets like you would think of any traditional microeconomic market. And oil is interesting because it's a microeconomic, it's one good or service that has huge implications on the macroeconomy, on the growth of nations and how they act and whatever else. But we can think of it in kind of classical microeconomic terms. That's the price of oil, that's the quantity of oil. You can imagine that those first few millions of barrels are fairly cheap to produce, and then every incremental millions of barrels, if you think about this as the quantity, the millions of barrels per day, they have to go explore, finding it harder and harder places, use more and more technology to find it, so the marginal cost of producing incremental barrels goes up. Another way of thinking about this, at a low price, oil producers say, hey, I'm going to leave that oil in the ground. Why should I pump it out and produce it now? So there won't be a lot of quantity produced, and at a high price, they're like, hey, we're going to pump as much as we can. We're going to find that oil wherever it is, and we are going to pump it and get it to the market. Two ways to interpret the long-run supply curve. long run supply. Now the demand also we can kind of view it in a classical way. Those first few millions of gallons, huge benefit to the consumers. There are some people that maybe oil is the only thing they can use. They can't go to any other source of energy. They get huge benefit, but then the marginal benefit goes down for every incremental barrel of oil. Another way of thinking about it, at high prices, there aren't a lot of people who are interested in doing it. They'll say, hey, thank you, I'll just go use something else. I'll use solar power, I'll walk to work, whatever else. But then at low prices, they say, hey, I'm gonna use all the oil I can use. I'm gonna drive my gas guzzler 100 miles to work. I'm just gonna drive it around the block for fun. I'm gonna leave it running because I don't like to start my engine and all the rest. So this kind of gives you a classical model, downward sloping demand curve and an upward sloping supply curve. And then you would end up with some equilibrium price in the long run and some equilibrium quantity. Now, this right over here does not describe this all too well, because between here and here, you did not have dramatic changes in how people, you know, in the amount of oil that was supplied into the market. You did not have dramatic changes in people's behavior in terms of how they consumed oil, whether they consumed a lot or a little of it. So one way to think about it is this is the long run. And you can even think about dynamics in the long run. If there is new technology to find new oil, the supply curve could shift to the right like this. If for whatever reason people start driving electric cars, then the demand curve could shift to the left like that. If for whatever reason it became fashionable again for people to drive SUVs, the demand curve could shift to the right. If countries' economic growth accelerate, if people in India and China end up becoming wealthier and want to buy more combustion automobiles, it could shift to the right. And so you could, in the long term, you can think about it in that way. If there's more drilling, if there's eases regulation on drilling, you could shift the supply curve to the right. If you increase environmental regulation, supply curve could shift to the left. And you could figure out the implications. Now, that's not what's really at play in the short run. And when I think about the short run, I'm not thinking about on a second-by-second basis. The short run is really we're thinking on over a period of months or even a small number of years. And that's because people aren't changing their behavior dramatically on kind of a month-to-month basis. They already bought their cars. They already bought their gas-guzzling SUVs. And also, it's not easy for suppliers to turn capacity on or off in the very short run. So in the short run, our model might look something like this. And obviously, these are gross oversimplifications, but they help us think about it a little bit. So this is the quantity, this is price. So in the short run, the quantity supplied is really not going to be too sensitive to price. So it might look something like this. And I'll just do it as a vertical line just to really state how in the short run, if we think about over a couple of months, people are just going to pump out the oil that they were planning on pumping out. They're not going to shut wells. They're not going to not use their tankers or whatever else to transport the oil. It's going to be produced and it's going to be transported to the market. So this is the short run supply curve, regardless of the price. In the long run, they might, if prices go down, they might decide to turn off capacity. If prices go up, they might do more exploration, open up more wells. But that takes time, often years to do that, especially if you start from the exploration phase. So this is supply, not too sensitive to price. And then demand might look something like this. And once again, this is just one way of thinking about it, a very simple model. Demand might look something, I'll do it in orange, might look something like this. Might look something like this, where it might look something like that. And the reason why I drew demand like that is it kind of fits at least people's short-term behavior. If the price, if our price right now is right over here, and then if it were to pop up right over there, in the short run, people don't change their behavior that dramatically. Their house and their work is still the same distance. It takes them a while to start thinking about moving a little bit closer, or changing jobs, or maybe getting a pass for public transportation, or maybe trading in their gas-guzzling car for another car, or carpooling, or whatever else. And if prices go down the other way around, they might still have their Prius. They're not, you know, they won't trade it in for a more gas-guzzling car, et cetera, et cetera. But what this describes is in the short run, the prices really aren't being dictated by kind of these classical microeconomic inputs or factors in terms of supply and demand. So what's really affecting them in the short term is kind of market psychology. And this is why I put a little picture of the Chicago Board of Trade, which is where they trade futures contracts. And futures contracts, and I've done videos where I go in detail on what futures contracts are, they're a way of trading commodities. Instead of people walking around with vials or barrels of oil and exchanging them, they say, hey, here's a contract to purchase oil from me in a month or at a specific date or 2 months at a specific date, and people trade those. And so in the near term, what's really driving the price of oil and what's really causing these fluctuations right over here that really can't be described by all of these things is people's psychology and people's information. And they look at things like the Middle East and they say, will Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, Israel's prime minister, decide to preemptively bomb Iran in an attempt to get rid of their nuclear program? And will Iran do something crazy? And how would they retaliate? And would they try to close off the Strait of Hormuz? And even if no one really believes that is happening, some of them might say, well, someone else might believe it, and then they might buy the futures contract and then try to trade it up. And other people, eventually that oil has to be delivered, they might take delivery of that oil but not bring it to market. They might hoard it in some way because they believe that something's going to happen and that oil is going to be scarce at some point in the future. So the big takeaway is all of these things, the production of oil, other sources of energy, people's behavior, they do matter in the long run on the price of oil. But in the short run, when we're talking about in the order of 6 months to a year, it really is market psychology. And some of these geopolitical events that might affect market psychology that's causing these wild swings in the price of oil.